Hello and welcome to this first in a short series of snapcasts looking at organic chemistry for GCSE. In this first snapcast in the series, we're going to take a look at hydrocarbons. And as the name would suggest, these are compounds made up of the elements hydrogen and carbon only. That's important. So a compound that has the elements carbon and hydrogen, and only those elements, is known as a hydrocarbon. A little bit of general advice here about revising your organic chemistry. Given that you've quite a lot to remember, and that what you have to remember consists of quite difficult equations and some chemical structures the like of which you've not seen before, I strongly advise that you use lots of rough-work paper and try drawing these structures out and try writing these equations out from memory, checking back with your original notes to see if you're getting it right. In my opinion, this is the only way to learn organic chemistry properly. Otherwise, if you simply depend on reading the notes and trying to retain it, you'll be disappointed when it comes to examinations. So fill up that waste paper basket with plenty of rough work paper that you've used to practice your organic chemistry. Now, to begin with, I'm going to tool you up, so to speak, with some basic language that you really must have before I can make much progress. Now, I'm not trying to teach organic chemistry here, or indeed in any of these snapcasts. The intention of the snapcast, by and large, is for me to speak to you as if I was talking to you as an individual in your own home, and giving you tuition. The only disadvantage for you is that you can't stop me and ask me questions. But there are plenty of advantages compared with home tuition. You can stop me whenever you like, you can use the scroll bar at the bottom. When I'm going over information that seems simple to you, you can push me forward. But really, it is important that you appreciate that the perspective that I have as I record these snapcast lessons is that of speaking to someone, an individual who's beside me. And I will make mistakes, although I've tried to put in a good deal of preparation with these slides. I will make mistakes as I go through, and I simply don't have the time to stop and redo them to a point of getting perfection. Okay, now, so tooling you up a little bit to get started. When it comes to naming organic compounds, there are books written on the rules for naming organic compounds. Somewhere before the middle of the 20th century, a group of chemists from countries all around the world came together to hammer out and agree a set of rules for naming organic compounds. And as far as we're concerned, there are two main rules that we need to apply and appreciate. First of all, the name of all organic compound is in at least two parts. The beginning part called the prefix and the ending, the suffix. Now, to begin with, the prefix is based simply on the total number of carbons found in a molecule of that substance. So if you had something like C2H6, a compound we'll come across shortly, that's got two carbons in it. This one maybe isn't just so obvious. Here's another compound which you have come across. It's present in vinegar. It's called ethanoic acid. How many carbons are present here? Sometimes people count that one and forget to count this one. Both of these have two carbons, and as a result, both of these have a name beginning with F. I'd like you to stop the snapcast for a moment and learn these six off. And then I'm going to test you in the next few slides. I pronounce them for you. This is meth, eth, prop, bute, not but, but bute, pent, and hex. These two are easy because pentagon's a five-sided figure, hexagon a six-sided figure. These are not so obvious, so spend a little bit more time with them. Okay, if you're ready, let's have a go. How many carbons has a compound with the prefix prop? Yep, three carbons. And what about pent? Yep, that's an easy one. It'll have a total of five carbons. What prefix would you use for one with one carbon? That's right. It would have to begin with meth. And prop, sorry, with two, what would you call that? That's called F. That's right. Okay. The other, I said there were two main rules that we need to think about before even starting organic chemistry, and that is, where does the suffix come from? The suffix, the ending of the name of an organic compound. Well, we'll see shortly that of the millions of different organic compounds, it is possible to place them into different families based on the fact that they have similarities, both in terms of the structure and the way that they react. Now, the ending of the name, the suffix, comes from the ending of the name of the family. And we'll just look at one here. We have a family called the Alkanes, the very first family we look at. And anything in that family ends with "-ane," which you can see has come from the name. This one we'll see comes from a family called alkenes. This one here, anol, an example of a chemical in that family you've come across even in junior science, is called ethanol. And it belongs to a family called alcohols. You can see where the anol has come from. Anoic acid is another, but we'll leave that for the moment. One more thing before we make a proper start. I'd like to refresh your memory about four possible types of formula that we come across: molecular, empirical, structural, and then another one which is kind of a halfway house between a molecular and structural formula. And I'm going to use ethanoic acid to illustrate this. Ethanoic acid has got a total of two carbons. It has a total of four hydrogens, and it has two oxygens. And this is its molecular formula. The molecular formula tells us A, what atoms are present, or what elements are present. In this case, it indicates carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. And B, it indicates the ratio in which they're present. Two carbons to four hydrogens to two oxygens. The empirical formula is obtained from that. The empirical formula is a simple, raw mathematical piece of data. And it's defined as giving the lowest whole number ratio of atoms present in a molecule of the substance. Now, the molecular formula at the moment indicates that we have two carbons, and we're using these as ratios, to four hydrogens to two oxygens. Now, could we put that in simpler terms? Because the empirical formula is the lowest whole number ratio of atoms. Yes, we could divide right across there by two. So it would be one carbon, two hydrogens, two, one oxygen. And as a result, the empirical formula is CH2O. Again, it gives the lowest whole number ratio of the atoms present in the molecule of the compound. Then there's the structural formula, and its name kind of gives it away. This actually indicates the way in which the atoms are joined together. In the case of ethanoic acid, we have two carbons bonded together. This one on the left is bonded also to three hydrogens. And then there's a double bond from this carbon to an oxygen, and a single bond to an oxygen, and then to a hydrogen. Don't worry too much about the detail of this. Just accept that a structure formula shows how the atoms are bonded to one another. But again, you saw in the molecular formula we had two carbons, and that's certainly the case here. We had four hydrogens, and again, if you count your hydrogens, you've got one, two, three, and four. And we had two oxygens, and again, you can see the two oxygens, one here and one there. And then what's this other formula? There is, I think, a name for this, which I don't recall at the moment. But this is essentially halfway between this one and this one. And it's written like this: CH3COOH. It goes a little bit further than this one, but it doesn't go quite as far as that one. It does indicate that the carbon, this carbon here, has three hydrogens attached to it, which is what we see here after all. And it does indicate the linking here, that we have a C, two O's and a H, but it doesn't go quite as far as this one, indicating the exact manner in which they are joined together. So take a moment to refresh your memory here of what we've covered: a molecular formula, empirical formula, structural, and then the other one, which is halfway between a molecular and a structural formula. Just one other quick example: butane. Butane has got four carbons and 10 hydrogens. and see how we can reason that formula out later. What would its empirical formula be? At the moment we've got 4 carbons to 10 hydrogens. Could we put that more simply? Well, we could divide by 2, couldn't we? What would that give us? That would be 2 carbons to 5 hydrogens. So what would the empirical formula be? C2H5. Now the structural formula shows the way in which the atoms are attached to one another. And the way in which they're attached, you'll have learnt this in due course, if you don't already know it, is like this. We are showing how the atoms are bonded to one another. This is a structural formula. And how do you think we might present it here? Well, here's the clue. What we do is we sort of take this bit here first of all. What have we got there? We've got a C with 3 H's. Then we take this bit next. What have we got here? We've got a C with 2 H's. Then we take this bit next. What have we got here? We've got a C with 2 H's. And then what have we got at the end here? We have a C with 3 H's. That's the formula halfway between a molecular and a structural formula. Okay, so far all that I've done is acquaint you with some terminology and some structures that I will have to deal with as we now proceed to organic chemistry. I'd like to move on then to take a look at the valency of carbon. I want to try to get across to you why, even though carbon is just one of 92 elements, that I spent about a quarter of my time as a student of chemistry on organic chemistry, the chemistry which deals essentially with the chemistry of carbon. What is it about carbon that makes it so important that we should spend so much time on it? Well, let's begin with valency. Two definitions for valency, one for ionic and one for covalent. Carbon forms compounds in which it is covalently bonded, so read this please. The number of electrons donated by the atom to the formation of covalent bonds. A moment ago we saw, I think, this compound, methane. And it forms whenever a hydrogen comes in here and bonds something like this. You're familiar with your covalent bonding. Another one comes in here and shares a pair of electrons. And another one comes in here and shares a pair of electrons. This is an example of covalent bonding. To go back to the definition of valency, how many electrons has carbon donated in the formation of covalent bonds here? Yes, it is donated 4. So the valency of carbon then is 4. And down at the bottom here, carbon always forms how many bonds in its compounds? Well, this is a typical example. And here we see carbon always forms 4 bonds. Valency of 4, and it always forms 4 bonds. Let's look at a couple of examples. Here's a chemical. I'm not even going to bother naming it at this stage. This is a compound in which carbon is found. This is an organic compound. Just check to see that every carbon has 4 bonds. Here's another one. This one's got what's called a double bond in it. And a double bond counts as 2. Again, just check there that every carbon has 4 bonds. This would count as 1. 2, 3, and 4. Now bonds are shared, which means this carbon here, in addition to 1, 2, it also shares these bonds, these here, so we count them for that carbon as well. We do also get some ring structures, like for example this particular one here with carbon. 6 carbons forming a hexagon ring. Now that doesn't look right, every carbon is only bonded to 2, but in this particular case each carbon is also bonded to 2 hydrogens. Again, you don't need to know the name of this compound, and I'm not going to tell you because it will perhaps possibly just distract from what I want you to learn, which is this. Carbon always forms four bonds, no exceptions. But make sure if there's a double bond present that you count that as two. And make sure that where you have a bond shared between carbons, that it counts for both carbons. This bond here counts for this carbon, but it also counts for that one. I'd like to spend a moment, though this particular covalent bond isn't on your GCSE course. I'd like to spend a moment showing how in ethane this bond forms between the two carbons. I'm looking specifically here at this bond here. And what happens is two carbon atoms, here are two carbon atoms, they come together and their outer shells overlap, and these two electrons will be shared. So this bond is created whenever the carbons share a pair of electrons. There will also be, as you see here, six, count the hydrogens, you'll see there are six hydrogens as well. Three, this one, for example, will go and bond there. This one will bond with that one. This one will bond with that one. And we've left with three here, aren't we? One, those three there. Well, those three will go round and bond over the other carbon. Another very important topic to consider in trying to explain to you why carbon is so important and why it takes up so much of our time studying it is this particular phenomenon known as catenation. Read what catenation is here. The ability of atoms of an element to join to themselves many times. We've seen already the way in which carbon can join to form chains. They'll always have four bonds, of course, but it can form chains of 2, 3, 4, 5, up to several hundred carbons long. And this is known as catenation, the ability for the atoms to be able to join to themselves time and time and time again to form long chains. Or indeed sometimes as well form rings. Now rings don't get much bigger than about 8 in number. Once rings get bigger than 8, here I'm just looking at one with 6, once they get bigger than 8, the ring begins to become unstable. So we don't get huge big rings. Now on this particular slide, my intention is to try and impress upon you what a treasure chest they discovered when they discovered somewhere at the beginning of the 20th century the fact that carbon could form chains of various length, and on top of that, attached here to the carbons, remember here, this represents where the carbons are joined together. Chemists call this a backbone structure, resembles your backbone or your spine. Now, I'm not sure how many carbons I've got joined to here, but I've got certainly quite a number of carbons joined. And this could go on up to several hundred long. Now, because the chain can vary in length, this gives huge numbers of permutations, huge numbers of possible organic compounds. But listen to the next point. These bits sticking out, well, quite often they'll have hydrogens attached to them. But why not stick on, for example, perhaps a bromine on one, or a chlorine on another? Or why stick to just single atoms? We could stick groups on somewhere. Why not stick, for example, an OH group on there? Or why not take a small bit of another carbon compound and stick it on here? Now you can see, because the bits that you're sticking on to this spine here, this backbone, because you can vary what you're sticking on, where you're sticking it on, there is virtually an unlimited number of different organic compounds that you can make. So, when this phenomenon was discovered at the beginning of the 20th century, chemists realized that in front of them they had the opportunity to produce huge numbers of different new compounds with the hope that they might discover new useful chemicals. And of course, over the last century we've discovered new drugs, new materials, including polymers and so forth. So this has been a treasure trove for for the chemists. Next, I'd like to take a look at the proper name for these families of compounds. We use the name homologous series. And by the way, series is both singular and plural. We talk about one series and two series, same spelling, same pronunciation. You need to know a definition of what a homologous series is. It's a family of organic molecules, and you need to remember these four things about the family. And I'll now take you through a series of slides that illustrate these points. That the members of a particular family, or homologous series, share a general formula. They have the same general formula. They show similar chemical properties. If you watch one of them react, one member of the family react, you can expect the other members of the family to react in a similar way. If one, in other words, undergoes combustion readily, then you can expect that various other members of that family will also undergo combustion readily. Another thing, the members of a family, as you go from one member to the next, and by that I mean the first member will typically have one, though sometimes the first member has two carbons, the next one will have three, and the next one four, and the next one five. As you move from one member of the family to the next, you will typically find a gradual change in the boiling point and the melting point and some other physical properties as well. Typically the boiling point will increase, but again we'll have a slide to illustrate that in a moment. And in due course I have a slide that illustrates this, that essentially what makes the difference, we take a look at, for example, ethane, which is the second member of one family called the alkanes. And let's take a look at the very next member. The very next member is this one. It's called propane. And it looks like this, going about quickly. And hopefully you'll notice the only difference between these two is this bit in the middle. I have inserted that in here. I have inserted, in effect, a C with two H's, and hence one member is differing from the next by what's known as a CH2 unit. And this happens with this family and with other families as well. Now, let us take a look at the first few members of the first family. This is always the first family we look at when we consider the families separately. So this first family, or the first homologous series to give it its proper name, they're called the alkanes. And I've already familiarized you with what a molecular formula is, and indeed a structural formula. Now the general formula of this particular family or homologous series is represented by this. It's C with an N and a H with a 2N plus 2. This 2N is written as a subscript and this 2N plus 2 is written as a subscript, smaller than the other letters. Now the N represents an integer, and an integer is a whole number. So we're talking about 1, 2, 3, 4. Now if N equals 1, then that means literally the N here takes the value 1, so we have C1. Now if it's a 1, we don't bother putting the 1 in, since the C is already there. We can see 1C, we don't bother putting in a 1. In the United States of America, I believe they do put the 1 in, but in the UK we don't do this. The C is there to be seen, it represents the 1 carbon. Now N is 1, what about this value then, 2N plus 2? Well, 2n is 2 times 1 is 2, plus 2 is 4, and that's where this 4 has come from. And the way we draw that out, in other words, the structure formula is like this. That is the structural formula of the first member of this family called the alkanes. Now, when n equals 2, this is the next member. Remember, they have the same general formula. Same general formula, and I'm going to move on to the next one, ethane, where N takes the value 2. So in this case it's CN, so we have C2. What will the 2N plus 2 bit be? That'll be 2 2s are 4 plus 2 is 6, so C2H6. What this formula means in simple language is this. The members of this family, the alkanes, have twice as many hydrogens as carbons, plus 2. This can be seen more easily if I draw out the third member, propane. Propane, you see, has 2 hydrogens for every carbon. Look, that carbon has 2 hydrogens, that carbon has 2 hydrogens, and this carbon has 2 hydrogens. Every carbon has 2 hydrogens. But you have a problem, that is at the start and the finish, where you need an extra hydrogen here and an extra hydrogen here. And this is where it comes from, if you think about it. Every carbon has 2 hydrogens, then you need 1 hydrogen for the start and 1 for the finish. And that's where this 2, I suppose, can be seen as coming from, plus 2. What would propane look like? Well, we've just shown propane, that's propane there. And butane would be 4 carbons. And, if you'll forgive me, speed time up. I'm going to leave the hydrogens out, if you can consider there's a hydrogen at the end of each of those bonds. Now, I've illustrated, if I go from propane to butane, I hope you can see all that I have done is I have inserted a CH2. You might consider that I've inserted a CH2. So the difference between propane and butane is simply a CH2. The difference between ethane and propane is simply a CH2. The difference between methane and ethane is simply a CH2. We insert another carbon and 2 hydrogens to lengthen the chain as we move from one family to the next. And you'll notice that these first 4 members of this family, the alkanes, are all gases. Let's look at the next family. These are called the alkenes. The only difference in the spelling is the E, where we had an A. So we had alkanes, now we have alkenes. Now, one very important difference with alkenes is that they have a carbon-carbon double bond, which we'll see in a moment. But let's consider why we have no such thing as ethane. Ethane is not possible. Can you see why? If I draw out that carbon and I put on 1 hydrogen here, I put on 1 hydrogen here, there we have CH2. So what's wrong with that? Yes, you've seen that carbon has only 2 bonds here and must have 4. So this compound cannot exist. What about ethane? Well, we have 2 carbons and those carbons will always be joined. Again, we seem to have a problem because, sorry, there's a mistake made here. This should, of course, say C2H4. This should say C3H6. And this should say C3H8. Sorry, C4H8. The general formula of an alkene is CnH2n. Should have started with that. Now, what we're saying in this case is that in the family of alkenes, they have exactly twice as many hydrogens as carbons. Now, with ethane has 2 carbons, C2, and twice as many hydrogens, 4. Now, if I was to put 2 hydrogens on each one, a hydrogen here and a hydrogen here, a hydrogen here and a hydrogen here, that wouldn't be right either, because each carbon is only bonded to 3 other atoms. And this is why in the case of alkenes, we always have 1 and only 1 carbon-carbon double bond somewhere in the molecule. When we come to propane also has a double bond, but only 1 double bond. It looks like this. Notice we've got 3 carbons and twice as many hydrogens, 6. And I hope that you can see that that's the number of hydrogens I've put in. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Each carbon has 4 bonds. Look at this carbon in the middle here, for example. It's got 1 there, 2 there, and this double counts as 2, making it up to 4. You should see that every carbon has 4 bonds. I doubt if you'd be asked, butene in your GCSE examinations, but let's take a look at it for a moment. There are four carbons. Now, there is a problem here in this. The double bond could be in one of two positions. It could either be in here, in which case the others would be single. So it would look like this. And I won't put the hydrogens on, but you should see there are eight single dashes there, at the end of which I should be placing a hydrogen. But, and this is the reason it's not on your GCSE course, this would be a different compound if I put the double bond in the middle instead. In fact, this is known as something called isomerism, which is not, I repeat, not on your GCSE course. And we look at that in AS chemistry. So, in other words, as far as alkenes are concerned, you will not be tested beyond propane. And do remember, there's no such thing as methane, because the carbon would not have enough hydrogens. And as far as those two members are concerned, ethene and propane, do notice that they are both gases. Now, I said I would return to this later in a separate slide. I'd like to illustrate what it means by that the members of a homologous series have these four things in common. And here we're looking at the fact that they show a gradation in their physical properties. Now, I have a graph here, but it's difficult to make out what it shows. But basically, this is what happens. If I was to take a look at a particular family of compounds, the alkenes, for example, what I would find would be this. If the one carbon compound, methane, if I took a look at its boiling point, and let's say this was 0 degrees centigrade, the boiling point, and I'm not sure exactly where it crosses this midpoint here, but if this was the boiling point, for example, of methane, I would find that the boiling point of the next member is slightly bigger. When a molecule has more atoms, it tends to have stronger, there will tend to be stronger forces of attraction between those molecules. So the bigger the molecule, the stronger the attractions between the molecules. And it takes more energy then to break them apart, so they have higher boiling points and higher melting points. So the next one might have a slightly higher, and the next one a slightly higher boiling point, and so on. So what we'll tend to get is, it may not be an absolutely perfect straight line, but it will have a gradual change, as is illustrated there. A different family might have something like this. It just depends on the family. But they will all show this slow change, gradual change, and this is where we get this idea of a gradation in their, and I emphasize, physical properties. Okay, let's push on. And then the fourth thing that we were looking at there, that they differ by a CH2 group, and I think I've shown you that already. It's not exactly very clear here, but if we take a look at the first three alkenes, here's methane. And to produce ethane, what I've done is I've slipped in a CH2 there. And then if I want to change from ethane to propane, what I've done is I've slipped in a CH2 there. And this is true of the alkenes as well. Here's ethene. And what I've done is I've sort of slipped in a CH2 here, it looks like. And if I move from that one, from propane to the next one, butene, again, it looks as if I've slipped in a CH2 there. There's another family that we'll be looking at shortly called the alcohols. Here's the first member. And look, if I slip in a CH2 there, and then if I want to move from this member to this member, look what I do, I slip in a CH2 there. So this is the significance of this. Now, where do we get organic chemicals? Today, the main source is from crude oil, from what is known as petroleum, something that is formed from prehistoric sea plants and animals. Anywhere we find oil is or was at one time covered by sea. We can also get organic chemicals from coal, and a word will be said about that a little bit later. But first let us take a look at the general aspects, some general aspects about fossil fuels that could be examined on. Try to provide the following information. Stop the snapcast and have a look at these. So to give examples of fossil fuels, how many fossil fuels could we name? And for fossil fuels, how were they formed? What would the key points be? Jot them down. And how should we define what a fossil fuel is? I'm about to bring up the answers now. So again, pause the snapcast for a moment and check these answers off. These are taken from a mark scheme. So spell out exactly what you need to be coming up with. Fossil fuels include natural gas. LPG stands for liquid petroleum gas, which is a mixture of methane, ethane, propane, butane, petrol, diesel, paraffin, candle wax, peat, lignite, coal. Lignite's a form of coal, somewhere between peat, I suppose, and coal. Coke. How were fossil fuels formed? From dead plants and animals. You must mention that it took millions of years. You need to mention that it required heat and pressure. How are fossil fuels defined? You must mention they're non-renewable, which means that they can become exhausted and that they will run out. You get many graphs like the one shown here in the corner, which give us some idea of when fossil fuels are likely to run out. Now, what do we do with petroleum or crude oil in order to get useful materials from it? First thing you need to appreciate is that crude oil, it's a thick black-brown liquid, extremely viscous. It is in fact a mixture of hundreds, probably, of different liquids with different boiling points, hundreds of different hydrocarbons that differ in boiling point. Now, we can't literally separate each of these out on its own, but what we do is we select out fractions of them. And we do this by a process called fractional distillation or fractionation. And this is roughly what happens. All of the crude oil, or almost all of it, is changed into a vapor by heating it. What doesn't vaporize will come out as the bitumen. The fractions with the lowest boiling point will have most energy as they enter the fractionating column, and they will be most difficult to cool and condense. So they will reach the top, and that's refinery gas. So that can be sold on as a fuel. The ones with the highest boiling point and with the least energy will be the easiest to condense. In this case, that will be the diesel oil. And then in between, we've got the petrol and the kerosene, which we also call paraffin. And here in the table below, you need to know the uses of these. You also need to know the changes in the properties of these, physical properties, as we move from refinery gas down towards the bitumen. In a class experiment, you may have seen the fractionation of oil or petroleum on a test tube scale, and you've seen that the first liquid to distill off is usually a colourless clear liquid, and that would be the petrol. The refinery gas, of course, will escape into the room, which explains why it should be carried out in the fume cupboard. As the fractions continue to come off, they get thicker, they become less runny, they say they become more viscous. They also become darker in colour. Also, as we move from petrol to kerosene to diesel oil, the fuel doesn't burn as readily and when it does burn, it tends to produce more soot and black smoke. And just take a look then at the uses of these fractions. Refinery gas can be used to make bottle gas, the LPG, liquid petroleum gas. Petrol, typically is used in cars. Kerosene or paraffin, typically used in home heating fuel. Some aircraft as well use it. Diesel oil is used for lorries and some cars. Also can be used in central heating. And then the bitumen is mixed with stones to make the surface for roads. Now it should be pointed out to you that some fractions of the oil are sent to the petrochemicals industry. That's not mentioned here, I think it probably comes in here, it's called naphtha. This is a particularly useful chemical, useful fraction from crude oil, for producing a whole range of chemicals including drugs and polymers. But while we should be using a lot of the oil for that purpose, in fact, typically today, about 90% of oil is burnt, and only 10% of it is sent off to the petrochemicals industry to be changed into materials, where it's known as a feedstock. Literally, it feeds the industry with its requirements to make a whole range of chemicals. But it has been said that petroleum is simply too valuable to burn. We should be looking for alternative fuels and making a much greater use of petroleum as a feedstock. Because when petroleum runs out, we're going to regret the fact that we burn so much of it. Now, let me take a look immediately here at some of the negative aspects of using petroleum, apart from the fact that it's a finite fuel that's slowly but surely running out. And I'm not going to dwell for more than a few seconds in each of these slides. So if these are of interest to you, you should stop the snapcast and make some notes from them. But here are some of the problems with oil spillages. They destroy habitats, they harm diving birds, and they cause an eyesore in the beaches and shores. And I've captured some information here on some notorious disasters at sea. In 1989, for example, the Exxon Valdez. And we've got 1.25 million barrels of oil released into the sea. There's a website here which takes a look at some of the most infamous cases, and possibly this is where I got some of these sources. The Amoco Cadiz in 1978, considered the worst oil spill, where we had 227,000 tons, not barrels, but tons of crude oil off the coast of Brittany in France. And then the Atlantic Express, where we had 474,000 gallons of crude oil. Unfortunately, the units there are different with gallons, tons, and barrels. It would be another dreadful disaster. You can see volunteer workers here that will have to work for months and months trying to clean up the mess when it hits the beaches. And then another famous one from the past, the Torrey Canyon. This happened in March 1967. One of the first disasters of this kind, where we had 120,000 tons of oil released into the sea. Now, the chemicals that are obtained from crude oil are known as hydrocarbons. Recall that I said that a hydrocarbon is defined as a compound made up of the elements carbon and hydrogen, and we must say only, very important to say only. Here's a compound that is not a hydrocarbon. It's called ethanol, it's an alcohol. Can you see why it's not a hydrocarbon? Yeah, because it also has oxygen in it. I'd like to spend just a very few moments, and again you can pause the slides if these should be of interest to you. These are not tested in GCSE to any extent. But coal is an alternative source And as oil becomes more and more expensive, we'll be forced to turn back increasingly to coal as a source of organic chemicals. But just in very simple form, what we do is we take the coke and we heat it in the absence of air, a process known as pyrolysis of coal or destructive distillation. And it breaks the coal down into three things essentially. Left behind in here is coke, which can be used by bakery ovens, can be used by the steel industry to reduce iron ore to iron. Coal gas comes off, and that can be fed through a network of pipes to people's homes, or to perhaps the electricity generating power stations, where it can be used as a fuel. But the most interesting bit, I suppose, is the coal tar. This is a bit like, it looks very much like oil, and it's a mixture of many different liquid fractions. It can again be separated by fraction distillation and used as a feedstock in the petrochemicals industry. And I'm just going to pause for a few seconds in each of the next three slides and tell you a little bit about each of the three fractions obtained from the destructive distillation of coal. As well on lignite. Now, lignite is mentioned on the Northern Ireland Chemistry GCSE syllabus. And we should be aware that up around Ballymoney, an Australian mining company had sought planning permission to mine for lignite. Lignite is a particularly poor grade of coal. It has quite a high content of water. And as coal burns, some of the energy in the coal needs to be used to boil off the water. And as a result, the energy value of such coal is much less than other types of coal like anthracite. Anyway, this mining company had mined and investigated the quality of the lignite, and had made a case that it would be economic to mine lignite. But there was considerable controversy over this matter, and over the last year or two, this plans to mine lignite seem to have been abandoned for the time being. Here are some of the issues concerned with the mining of lignite. For a start, it's open cast mining, so literally heavy machinery go in and just simply take the soil off the top, damaging whatever ecosystems might be there, scarring the countryside, creating all kinds of dust. Now, one can certainly make arguments in favour of lignite mining, not the least of which would be the bringing of a huge amount of employment to the area. Okay, more could be said on lignite, but I leave you to do that research yourself. Now I'm going to take a look at the chemistry of the alkanes. Remember again, general formula shared by all the members of the alkanes is CnH2n+2. First member is methane. It's got one carbon, so N is 1. And if we take 2n+2, that's 2 2s are 4 plus. Sorry, 2 1s are 2 plus 2 is 4, so H4. And this is how it looks. This is a molecular formula, and this here is its structural formula. Pause the snapcast and fill in the structures for ethane and propane. Ethane has got two carbons, and then we make sure that we put in all the bonds. Every carbon must have four bonds, though this bond in the middle here counts for both the left carbon and the right carbon. And then we stick hydrogens at the ends of each of the bonds, and if the formula is right and we've got the right number of bonds, then everything should match up as it does here. What did you get for propane? Well, there are three carbons. Propane, prop is 3, so it's got 3 carbons. We go back up to the formula, CnH2n+2, so C3, and then 2n+2, that's 2 3s or 6 plus 2, is 8. three carbons will be joined together. We then put in enough bonds to make sure every carbon has four bonds, and then we put in the hydrogens at the ends of each of those bonds. And that's what propane looks like. Can you remember that other type of formula, the way we write it? CH3, CH2, CH3. An alternative way, there's the CH3, there's the CH2, there's the CH3. Not very clear the slide, but it shows there's methane. If we insert a CH2, an extra CH2, we get ethane. Put in another extra CH2, we get mixed member propane. Stick in another CH2, we get butane. Stick in another CH2, we get pentane, and so forth. I don't expect you'll see very much more in the slide, but I can see here that the boiling point of methane is minus 164 degrees C. We move up higher boiling point of minus 89 for ethane. We move up to a higher boiling point of minus 42 for propane. We move up to minus 1 degree centigrade for butane. So at room temperature, 20 degrees C, it's still gas. And when we get to pentane, this would be a liquid, but what we call a very volatile liquid, one with a low boiling point, and one that will vaporize very quickly, because its boiling point isn't that high above room temperature. Its boiling point is 36 degrees centigrade. But it would be classified as a liquid at room temperature, pentane. And hexane, which is used in some lighters, cigarette lighters, is a liquid as well. Its boiling point is, I see here, 69 degrees C. Alright, let's take a look at the reactions of alkanes as represented by ethane. Well, you'd be glad to know that there aren't many reactions of alkanes. They are, compared to other families of compounds, considered relatively non-reactive. And indeed, the only reaction we consider for the alkanes is combustion. And combustion is defined as burning a substance completely in excess oxygen. And alkanes will react with oxygen to form two products, carbon dioxide and water. Remember, alkanes are hydrocarbons. Hydrocarbons. The hydrogen in the hydrocarbons reacts with oxygen to form water, which is essentially hydrogen oxide, and that'll come off as steam. And the carbon in the hydrocarbons will react with the oxygen to form carbon dioxide. Now, what's so significant and so important about these combustion reactions of alkanes is that they are extremely exothermic and they release a lot of energy. Here's one particular example, propane, C3H8, remember, in the formula, twice as many hydrogens as carbons, plus two, one for the start with the chain, one for the end. It reacts with oxygen to form carbon dioxide, water, and energy. In a moment, we'll look at how we balance these reactions. If we wanted to carry out an experiment to prove that carbon dioxide and water, or steam, are the products of combustion, this is how we would do it. Here we see an inverted funnel and a delivery tube which brings material into this U-shaped tube here, or a U-shaped tube here, with an outlet here that goes through into a second tube, and any gases will bubble through, and then out through that tube to a suction pump. And the suction pump is what's driving it. It's sucking everything in this direction, so it will suck air from the room in this direction up through the inverted funnel, filter funnel. Now, the fuel burns here. Here's the flame, for example, methane burning. And the suction caused by this pump on the right-hand side, drawing the air in from the room, will draw in the products of the combustion. And we want to prove that carbon dioxide and water are produced. Now, what we will do here is, as the mixture of air and the products of combustion, which we expect to be steam and carbon dioxide, as they arrive in here, we have here a beaker with ice water, and that should cool and condense the steam. And all we need to do is to collect some of this liquid and use anhydrous copper sulfate, which is a white powder. And if it is water, then it should turn the white anhydrous copper sulfate blue. Go from white to blue. And that would be a positive test for water. It uses anhydrous copper sulfate, which is this formula. And when it combines with water, it forms hydrated copper sulfate, which is this formula. It's water of crystallization, CuSO4.5H2O. Meanwhile, the carbon dioxide will not condense. It'll continue on through here into some lime water, where it should turn it milky as a positive test to indicate that CO2 is indeed a product of the combustion of the hydrocarbon. So in summary, the hydrocarbon, perhaps methane, is reacted with oxygen in the combustion reaction, forming carbon dioxide and steam. Let's take a look at the important differences between complete combustion and incomplete combustion. Complete and incomplete. Complete combustion occurs when there's a plentiful supply of oxygen or air. The products are carbon dioxide and water, or steam. Whereas in incomplete combustion, the fuel is burning in a limited supply of air. There isn't enough oxygen being supplied to change all the carbon to carbon dioxide. And unfortunately, we get carbon monoxide and steam produced. And there are two drawbacks to this. Number one, carbon monoxide is poisonous, and it's a silent killer. It doesn't make you cough and choke. It simply makes you drowsy and fall asleep. And carbon monoxide, unfortunately, combines and binds with the hemoglobin in your blood in the same way that oxygen does. But unfortunately, carbon monoxide, once it's combined with your hemoglobin, it doesn't come back off again. And your hemoglobin, slowly but surely, gets tied up. And then you end up in a dreadful, in a precarious situation where you have no oxygen carrier in your blood. And you will suffocate and die. I said there were two drawbacks. The second drawback is, and you can see this more clearly in a moment, the reaction is not as exothermic. And as a result, you're not getting as much energy and you're wasting fuel. Some of the environmental points. Combustion, increased levels of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere causes global warming. It causes what's known as the greenhouse effect, which leads to global warming. And global warming, in turn, leading to things like the rising of sea levels and more extremes of climate change. These are the kinds of things you'd be asked for. You should be able to come up with some examinations. Now let's look at some of these examples of combustion. Here is methane. Now, when methane reacts in a plentiful supply of oxygen, it forms carbon dioxide and water. Let's see how we balance this. How many carbons are there in methane? One. How many carbon dioxides can you get from one carbon? The answer is one. So that will produce one molecule of CO2. Now methane, how many hydrogens is methane? Four. How many hydrogens does a water molecule have? Two. And that's why from one molecule of methane you can get two molecules of water. Now, how many oxygens have we on the right-hand side? Well, in a molecule of carbon dioxide, we have two. And in two molecules of water, we have another two oxygens, one in each. So we have a total of four times oxygen on the right. And we must now balance that on the left, which is done by taking two times O2. The same process is used here for ethane. How many carbons have we in ethane? Two, which allows to form two CO2s. How many hydrogens do we have in ethane? Six, from which we can get half as many water molecules, three H2Os. How many oxygens have we on the right? Well, in two CO2s we have a total of four oxygens, and in three waters we have three oxygens. So we have a total of seven oxygens on the right, which we have to balance here, and that's done by taking 3.5 O2s. And one more, propane. How many carbons have we in a propane molecule? Three. which will allow us to form exactly three CO2s. How many hydrogens do we have in a propane molecule? 8, which will allow us to form half as many water molecules, 4. And then lastly, to balance the oxygens, how many oxygens have we on the right? Well, we've got 3 2s or 6 here, and 4 here. So we have 10 oxygens on the right, which will be balanced on this side by taking 5 O2s. Now, I said these reactions are very exothermic. When methane burns, chemists have worked out that when 1 mole of methane burns in plentiful supply of air, we get 75 kilojoules released. Now, I didn't look the figure up here for ethane, but because ethane is producing more molecules of CO2 in water, this figure will certainly be bigger. It will be higher than 75. And indeed, propane here, which is producing even more molecules of CO2 in water per mole of itself, that will be even more exothermic. So this figure here is going to be even bigger. It will be the biggest of these three. Down here we see one of these imitation log fires, and they typically use propane gas. Now I see that we've run just over an hour at this stage, so I'm going to have to push on as quickly as I can. Just a quick word on hexane. This would not really be, you wouldn't be required to look at its combustion, but hexane is present in some cigarette lighters. Could you balance the equation at the bottom here? Pause the snapcast and have a go. If you could balance this, then you should be able to balance any. Use the same principle we looked at a moment ago. Okay, you have 6 carbons. How many carbon dioxides can you get from that? That's right, 6. How many hydrogens are there? 14. How many water molecules could you get from that? Yeah, half as many, so 7. How many oxygens have we here? 6 2s or 12. How many oxygens have we here in the water? 7. So we have 12 in the carbon dioxides, and 7 here. That's 19 oxygens on the right. And that would be obtained by taking how many oxygens over here? Is it 9.5? Okay, let's move on. Just to summarise the important differences between complete and incomplete combustion, I've summarised them here. First of all, let's take a look at the complete and incomplete combustion of coal, which is essentially carbon. This is complete combustion here. It all turns into CO2, and this is how much energy we get released from a mole of coal or carbon. Look how much less we get when it's incomplete combustion. There isn't enough oxygen getting into the room or into the fire, and as a result we get dangerous carbon monoxide produced, and we get much less energy produced. In fact, this figure here shows how much energy is wasted. And similarly, same sort of exercise done for methane. Here's the complete combustion, produces carbon dioxide and this much energy. If there is not sufficient air, then we'll get carbon monoxide produced, and we'll get less energy, and this is how much less we get. This is the energy that's being wasted. One last thing on alkanes. I'd like to take a look at what happens during the cracking of a hydrocarbon. When we crack a hydrocarbon, as the name suggests, we literally break it into smaller parts. And we do this usually with high temperatures and pressures, and sometimes using a catalyst to enable us to use lower temperatures. But you can see here what's happening in this. The molecule is being cracked here, with a red line is being shown, and it literally breaks bonds between the carbon atoms. In this case, it's breaking a molecule consisting of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 carbons long, and it's breaking it up into 3 smaller molecules. This consists of 3 carbons. It also noticeably has a carbon-carbon double bond. for it belongs to the next family we'll be considering, called the alkenes. And it's also produced this smaller two-carbon compound, which also has a double bond. And then it's produced this other one that looks more like an alkene with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 carbons. So you see the total is 13 carbons altogether. Why do we do this? Well, we wouldn't be doing it with a hydrocarbon as short as 13 carbons, but with those that consist of 30 or more carbons, they are a lot less useful and a lot less sought after in the shorter chain alkenes. And this is a process of breaking long chain hydrocarbons down into shorter, more useful hydrocarbons. And you should also appreciate that these compounds with the double bonds are in fact far more useful in the petrochemical industry for producing drugs and polymers than the alkenes are. These shorter alkenes can be used as fuels, and these ones with the double bonds can be used in the petrochemical industry. So cracking makes a lot of sense. Just pause the snapcast and take in some of the points here that would be looked for in examination questions of thermal when cracking comes up. You need to be able to explain what it is. It takes longer or larger hydrocarbon molecules that are not as useful and breaks them into smaller ones. It's a process that uses heat. In the absence of air, sometimes uses a catalyst. You could try doing this one perhaps. Use an excise, crack this molecule into an ethene molecule and a propene molecule, where an ethene molecule has the formula C2H4. This is unfortunately a bit of an overlap because we haven't studied alkenes yet, but propene has the formula C3H6. Each of these, the ethene and the propene, each have one carbon-carbon double bond. But you could maybe have an attempt at that. Pause the snapcast and see how you get on. Well, ethene looks like this. And I suggest that it could be produced in the following way. If we were to break it so that it went like this, broke across like that, that would give us 1, 2, 3, 4 hydrogens, which is what we've got here. And of course these two carbons, so that would be alright. I'm also supposed to produce propene, and we'll have to break that something like this. That propene looks like this. It's got three carbons. It's a double bond. Two of the carbons are linked by a double bond. It looks something like this. C3H6. And then we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 other carbons there. So we would end up with 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And I'll not put the hydrogens in, but there's a hydrogen at the end of each of these bonds. And that would be called, that's got 7 carbons and it's an alkene. What would it be called? Well, 7, I didn't teach you that, but 7 has the prefix hep, as in a 7-sided figure, a heptagon. And it's known as heptene. Hep because it's got 7 carbons, and ene because it belongs to the family called alkenes. And we would have ethene, and this here is called propene. Don't worry about that, that'll come up when we look at the next family. Now, I'm going to stop the snapcast at this point and look at alkenes separately, just simply because I see the time running on. And we'll be coming back to take a look at alkenes and at least some others. But at a glance you can see right away the difference between an alkane structure and the structures of these others. It's very easy to spot that an alkene has got a carbon-carbon double bond. And in terms of alcohols and some of these other families, they have got what we call a functional group, which in the case of alcohols, this red bit is an OH. In the case of carboxylic acids, it's a COOH. But we'll see that in due course. So thanks for listening. And please go on to see the next snapcast, which will complete our look at the hydrocarbons by looking at the chemistry of alkenes.